Hello, Nader here. Welcome back to the Human Resource Machine. Last episode, we completed the alphabetizer with a perfect score. And now we are gonna move onwards with the scavenger chain. So what is a scavenger chain? Yes, it's getting a little drafty up here. Facilities management has been notified, but we still have work to do. Each bear on the floor contains one data. To the address of another one of the pairs. It's a scrambled chain. Each thing in the inbox is an address of one of the pairs. Outbox the data for that pair, and also the data in all following pairs in the chain. The chain ends when you reach a negative address. Repeat until the inbox is empty. Interesting. So, let's walk this through. We read the first thing from the inbox, that's 23. That means we need to outbox whatever 23 is pointing at. Then we advance this one and then we follow whatever is in the next one. So this one points to 10. So we point here. So we send out P. Then we check the next one, that's 20, that's here. We send this one out. And then we have a negative number. And then we stop. And then we grab the next one, which is going to be E. Which leads us to 13, which is gonna go D. So we shall send out the S, and this one sends us to 3, which sends us to C, and we send us to 23, and we follow the chain again. Interesting, I like it. Tell me more. You might also call this technique of storing data a linked list. You can explore more about this fascinating subject. Why are you not at work? Yes. I don't think this manager really appreciates the concept of learning on the job. But that's why he's management. Okay, so as always, we begin with getting something from the inbox. And that immediately. We need to go there. Okay, so we need to have a temporary place to store something. So. This one. This is gonna be our pointer. So we store it in the pointer box. Okay. Then we jump to whatever. Alright, no, we don't jump. We copy from whatever the pointer is pointing at. So then we read out the E, and then we send it to the outbox. Okay, fair enough. Then we need to bump the pointer, so it will stop pointing at the first one and points to the next one. And then we need to copy from whatever the pointer is pointing at. So we read in the value, and we need to store it in the pointer, so we replace the pointer. It becomes self-replacing. And after that, there is going to be a bit of looping because we can go back to reading the value that the pointer was pointing at and we send it out. The thing is though, this doesn't repeat enough and it doesn't end. So we need to double check once we pick up the pointer value before we store it. If it's negative, we need to jump out. Okay, so what if we are jumping out? Basically, it means we are done. So we can just go back to the beginning. This is a pretty elegant one, I think. Let's see if I'm completely on the mark or off the mark. So this one points us to, boom, we send it out. Okay, then we bump it. So then we copy that one. So 10 becomes the next pointer, then we send it there and we send it out. So far, so good. Next one, 20, put it in. Okay, that's good. So send out the E. And then this negative one is what we're gonna look at. Okay, it's negative. So it means we're done. Yes, we grab the next one, we reset the pointer, and we go. Excellent. Ape, escape. Okay, speed wise, perfect. size-wise, we need to shave off one instruction. What did I miss? Let's copy this. So we copy, and then next tab we paste. So strictly speaking, is there anything that we have duplicated? Usually if you duplicate things, there are options there. So copy for something from a PTR. And we're sending it to the out box. Maybe we can shift some things with that, because we twice reached the value from the pointer. On the other hand, of course, the first value is the stored value. There's no point in analyzing it because it's always going to be sent straight out. And we bump the pointer, so we point at this and we read it, because you need to pick it up in order to do something with it. Then if it's negative, we jump out, sure. And we copy it to the pointer. We also copy something here to the pointer. So maybe if we point one up and we take this one out, basically we integrate it into the loop. That seems better. I think this, but there was an even more elegant solution just waiting out there. And I don't think this will have any impact on execution speed. So this is exactly on the mark. Okay, so this is the solution that I was meant to make with this one. Well, that was pretty quickly. So, well, let's dive into the next one. Digit Exploder. Our users have been rating some of our hardware products with 1 star. With user reviews citing, draws too much power and overheats. Numbers are too complicated for test subjects. Occasionally removes alarming volume of skin from human users. So management has come up with a solution to make the numbers smaller and easier to understand. Right. Grab each number from the inbox and send its digits to the outbox. For example, 1 to 3 becomes 1, 2, 3. Okay. Interesting. There is no option for 0 stars, because research groups were found to be in disagreement about the nature of 0. Okay. So these numbers here at the bottom are not by any coincidence. So basically we are going to divide things here. Okay, so 5 is only, let's see, okay, so we can take a number, and basically if we want to decompose it, so let's say a number like 925, this can, if you want to split it up into groups or into 3 different letters or different numbers, 9, 2, and 5, basically with a sequence 9 to 5, it indicates how many times you have 100 in it. That's 9 times. Then you got 2 times 10, and you got 5 times 1, which basically it's a multiple of the order of 10. It's a single digit thing. It scales this way. It's interesting that this is a 0, not a 1. Otherwise you would have 11. So it's makes it okay. So what we can do is we can take a number, and if we subtract 100 and the number is still positive, then we know at least it has a multiple of 100 in it. So we can repeat that until the number goes below 0. At that point we know we subtracted 100 1 times too many, so we can revert it. After that we can do the same with tens. So let's take this number for example. If we subtract 9 times 100, we end up with 25. And somewhere a counter indicating that we have 9 times 100 in it. Okay, then next up, it's reduced to 25. Well, we can subtract 2 times 10. And then that leaves us with 5. The third time would reduce it to negative 5, so we know 2 is the limit. After that, we got 5 remaining, which is exactly the number that we care about as the last one to send out. So there is an idea there that basically we can decompose this by just subtracting these magical numbers a multiple number of times until we go over the limit. Okay, so let's see, this is, let's call this the num. This is the number that we are decomposing. So if we take the number in, we store it in the num. Okay, so we got 5. Well, we all probably also need to set up a score keeping thing. So maybe do that even earlier. So we prepare it. Then we copy from 0. Let's see, actually call this 0. This is very creatively call this 10, and very creatively call this 100, because that's exactly what the numbers are in this case. So we copy from 0, and this is, we copy it to 2. Let's keep a counter here. And we also copy it to another counter there. So this is how many times we do 10. And this is how many times we do 100. And the thing is, then the remaining number is going to be the, well, actually just let's keep it clean. We actually change it. So we have, if we want to decompose this number, we start with how many times it's 100. Then is how many times it's times 10. And we end with how many times it's times 1. So we take the number and we store it in the times 1. Then we copy from 0 and we copy it to the times 100 and the times 10. So I'll show you what I have in mind. So we take some steps. I see X advance this. So we put 5 here. Then we put 0 here and 0 here. So the number 5, you can write it as 005, because it's 0 times 100, 0 times 10, and 5 times 1. That's 5. So we could output this exactly this way. 005 is how we can send it out. I don't think we need to output zeros, but sure. Okay, so this is a setup. Now we need to check if the times 1 number is bigger than 10. We need to work with it. Also, if it's so we need to do the checks in turn. First, we check if it's larger than 100. So we count 100s. 100s. So we copy the value from here and we subtract 100. Okay, so we're holding a value in our hands. If the number is negative, we know we have reached the limit. Otherwise, we should process and continue. We have the tens next. So just as an indication that we're jumping to that section next. But first, okay, so if we have, again, let's say we have this digit here, 445. So if you subtract 10, or subtract 100, it's still a positive number because it's going to be 345. That's more than enough. So what we need to do then is we write the number down in our times one and we bump the 100 count. Okay. And then we repeat. And at some point, we repeat it, and at some point, the number in our hands will be negative. So we know we don't touch it, so we jump out of it and we go check in the tens. And we do this exact same thing here. So we copy the number from the ones, then we subtract 10. And if it's a negative number, we know we have reached our limit. Because again, if you have the number 11, you subtract 10, you keep 1. If you got the number 5, you subtract 5, it becomes negative. So if it's negative, we have reached our limit. Otherwise, we can just bump the tens. And we actually, no, we need to write it first down, and then we bump the tens, and then we just jump back to our check. Okay. Let's do it nicely like this. So here we are done, basically. Once we reach here, done. Because we have extracted all the multiples of 100 and all the multiples of 10. So at this point, we should have a number in here that's less than 10. Which means we can send out all the numbers. So then we can do a copy from this number and we outbox it. Then we do a copy from this number and we outbox it. And then we do a copy from this number and we outbox it. And at this point we are done and we can go all the way back to the beginning. So this is a very straightforward solution that utilizes the fact that I know that there's only 3 digits. If I had to account for multiple digits, and basically an infinite length number that you had to decompose, it would be trickier, because then you need more positions, you would have to keep pointers, you would have to terminate things. So this is a very, this should be very straightforward. Okay, so we cannot send out the zeros. That's an extra check we have to build in. So we copy the value, and if it's a zero, we just skip it and we go to the next. And I don't think we ever got a zero, so we can safely skip that. Interesting. So if it's, oh wow, okay, so we need to skip the first zeros until we find a digit that's not a zero. And then we need to send out all the remaining digits. So I could solve this with pointers. Keep a pointer pointed at the first one and keep advancing it until we reach a non-zero one and then send out everything. And then basically we need to zero pad it in the end to know that we are done. But it's probably easier to just think through all the possible options. If we have the value 3, then it's the 0, 0, 3. So we need to ignore both zeros. On the other hand, if you have 907, we need to send out everything. But in case of 79, the first zero we skip, and then 79 means we have to do it. So we need to account for how many zeros there are, basically. Ja. So the first one, if it's a zero, we can safely skip it. After that, we need to know if we have actually skipped it or not. So let's create a special case for that. So if the first one is a zero, we skip out. And then we know we are still looking for zeros. Otherwise, if the second one is then a zero, because we know we didn't actually jump, the first one was not a zero, so the 9-0 situation here, we don't actually need to skip it. Okay, but what if we have 0-3? Yeah, so then we have another situation where we have to get out. Okay, the situation that we have here, if there is at any point a leading zero, we go out, so we know basically that in this case we are done. Also, it doesn't really matter if the... Yeah, okay, I was overcomplicating things. So if the first digit is a zero, we bail out. So we know that in this case, it's a situation where we have a digit followed by two other digits. Or maybe just do it digit, digit, digit. Three digits. Okay. If we jump out, we know we have a zero and potentially two digits, which is the next situation we account for. So we ignore the first one and then we just copy the second digit, send it to the outbox, and we copy the third digit and we send it to the outbox. And after that, we jump all the way back to the beginning. There is duplication going on here, I know that. Okay, but what if the second one we pick up is also a zero? I mean, we have the three which becomes a 0, 0, 3. We don't want to send out the first zero, so again we need to check. So we have the value, we copy it. Okay, in this case we know we always want to send out the last one. I mean, we don't get zeros, so the last one is always present. So in that case, we can simply move over. Also, what we can do, I mean, because it doesn't really matter, we can jump back to this earlier bit and then use the jump that's already there. Does it matter? No, let's wait, let's keep it clean. So if we have a zero, we skip outputting this digit. And either way, we always output the last digit. So I think we now have a working solution. It's 5, 3, 4, so this should become a 5, this should become a 3. And this will remain a 4, and we send them out. We initialize it to 0, and this we only send out to 3. Excellent! We have a working solution. Working solution achieved. Excellent. And how efficient are we? Okay, we use one command too many, but we can fix. Speed challenge. We need to get a couple of cycles off. To be precise, we need to get 44 cycles off. So let's have a look. We can copy this one and open up a new tab and we paste it. There is a bit of inefficiency going on here in the end. Basically, we are done at this point after 17 instructions, and then we spent another 14 instructions on basically just sending the output out. Which is a bit much if you think about it. And on top of that, we have a solution here that uses 7 instructions, and then afterwards we have another 6 instructions that we use for the second edge case. So maybe we can merge some things. See if we can make it slightly more efficient by just shaving one instruction out. So if the first, basically we need to remember what we were doing. And in this case, the instruction pointer is basically where our memory is. The location in the code determines what we are doing. So this is for the triple digits, this is for the double digits, and single digit is kind of muffled off to the side. But the logic is always the same. So in this case, I was already alluding to it before. If the second digit here is a 0, we already jump out and we want to jump over here to only send out the last digit. Okay, that's fair. But we also want to send out the other 2 digits, but we already have code up here that does that. So why are we duplicating logic if we can reuse it? Okay. So we can check out these, and this is how we get the solution to be shorter than we needed than the target. So let's analyze this again. So we have, then the first one is a 0. We know that because that's how we ended up here. That's this jump here. First digit is a 0. Yes, jump over. Okay, then we need to check the second digit. And if it's a 0, then we know we only care about the last one. If it's not, then we need to process the last 2 digits. And what we can do is we can just jump back. And we already did the reading from the times 10 label. So we don't need to repeat that. But it is a decision condition, that's why we do read it here. But afterwards we can just jump and we can continue executing as if we had this code in line here. That way we have 28 instructions and the runtime should be more or less the same. So let's see if my thinking is actually correct. But this is only solving part of the optimization problem. We still need to make it faster, which means something in this main loop needs to be faster. Because shaving off 44 instructions, that means the core loop is too slow. And indeed, we optimized the size challenge. And we actually made it one slower because we introduced an extra jump along the way. So let's have a quick look at that one. So digit exploder, we copy you, and then we paste you in the third one and see what we can do to optimize this. Okay, so we are done here and we are set up. Okay, so the setup code is only run once, so that's not going to make a major impact. We can ignore that for now. Okay, so we have this logic here for working with deconstructing the number. So we can, let's see, we copy it from 1. We subtract 100. If it's negative, we bail. Otherwise, we know that the new number we can just safely store it away. And then we bump the next one and then we jump back. Okay. There's not a lot that you can optimize about that, I think. I mean, it's really, really straightforward. Next up. Well, let's analyze that bit first of all. Let's say we have the number 3. How many redundant instructions are executed to achieve that? So we get in here, we read it, we subtract 100, it's negative, so jump over. So 1, 2, 3, jump over. Okay, now we read it, the number once again, we subtract 10, and that becomes negative, so we jump once again. So that's another 3 instructions. Okay, then here we are done, because we know this number cannot be further decomposed. And after that, we know we can flush it. So there are about 6 instructions in overhead if we don't need to process the first 2 digits. So that doesn't seem too bad, honestly. Okay. So I'm currently thinking, what if you work with multiples? So rather than 100. What if you also have 200 and maybe even 400? I mean, we're not using the space in here. So you could say, well, we set up 100, 200, and 400. And then you make multiple of the checks. Because right now, this loop for determining how many times 100 goes in, 907. You subtract 109 times to get it down to 007, and then once more to basically trigger the fail condition. But this loop, the successful loop, is you copy it 1, 2, 3, do you have to do the check, copy, bump, and jump. So there's 6 cycles involved in a successful deduction. So this 9, you need to run it 6 times. So you get 9 times 6, which is 54. 54 cycles to decompose the number 9. And then you need to not run another 3 cycles to actually escape from that. So what if you could break it down into like 400, 400, and 100? Then you only need to run your full cycle 3 times. So there are some options for that. The code is going to be horribly long, horribly complex, but it might just work. Okay, let's get started on that. Let's see with at least from the 100 to 200, and then if that example works, we can just extrapolate that to the 400. So when we have the 100, this is all part of the setup, the initial setup even. So we copy from 100, we add 100, we copy it to this one. So this we name 200. And this one we call 20. And we don't need to do it for the 0, so that saves a little bit of work. Okay, so copy from 100, add 100, copy to 200. It actually reads the way you would expect it to be working. So we copy 100, we add another 100, and we copy it to 20. 10, 10, 20, I mean. Okay, this is the very first setup. We only need to do it once, and after that, the numbers are, well, same, basically. Okay, so here, rather than decomposing tens, we first start with 100. We need to decompose 200. So, 200. There is a jump in here somewhere. So, basically, we need to. So we copy from the first value, we subtract the 200 value. Wait, we should actually subtract 200, right? Not 5. Okay. If it's negative, we know that's not what we need. So we need to escape from the loop, and we just need to check the 100s. If it's the case though, we can store the value, and then we need to bump this one twice. And that's all there is to it, and in the end the same counter applies. So let's see if this still produces the good result. And there's a little bit of overhead in setting up the 20s, even though I'm not using it. 907 is going to be the ultimate test. This idea works. This works. Okay. And he's happy, and it's faster? No, not yet. It's actually one step faster, but I have incurred a lot of overhead. So I'll go back and let's clean this up. So 200 to 100. Then next up, jump if. So maybe I should actually have the label and then the pointers afterwards, just to indicate where it is, because it's getting a bit tricky to see what stops where. That way, if you jump underneath a label, you know you go to the code that belongs to it. So 200, 100, 20 are the tens, and then we have the done. Alright, so this section needs the 20s. No, actually this section needs it, so we add the 20s. And we need to jump to checking the 20s before we check the 10s. It's as before. So we copy the value from 1x, we subtract the 20. Then if it's a negative, we know it's not a match, so we jump over to the next one. Otherwise, we know we have a valid value, so we can save it, and then we bump the 10x twice. And then we need to jump back to check again. Okay, so this should, I don't know, it's gonna be under 200, I think. And then we do it for 400 as well, because that gives us the most savings, and that's probably going to have the most impact. $190. See? Okay, so last one. We will have a 40. And we will have a 400. We need some setup code for that, so there is a fixed bit of overhead. So we, and the thing we did here with copying from 100 and doubling it, we can do the same thing. So we copy, we have at this point we have 100, we add 100, so we have 200 in hand, so we copy it. At this point we can just add 200 and we can copy it to 400. That way we only need two instructions to make 400. And we can do the same thing for 40. By at this point we have 20 in our hands, so all we need to do is add another 20. And then we can copy it to 40. Okay, so we need to check here, 400. Okay, so we have our loop underneath, we copy the value from 1x, we subtract 400. If that number is a negative, we know it's, we don't have a multiple of 400, so we can jump over to see for the 200s. And if you're cheating, you could actually see, well, we got 900 and we got 500. So 900, it fits 400 two times, and then you have 100 remaining, but no 200. 500 here, again, you can fit 400 in it, but then you'll have 134 left, so you can't get another 200 out. So I could optimize this for this specific set of data by taking the 200 check out. Depending on what the solution ends up being, I might need to do that. But that's just an aside. On the other hand, 79 is 40 plus 20 plus 10. So you need to decompose it all the way there. Okay, I was busy with this. So the 400s. After we are done, we need to save the number and then we need to bump the 100 four times. And bump it once more. Okay, and then we go back and we analyze it again. Okay, then we got the 200s, then we got the 100s, and before the 20s, we need the 40s. And then the jump that goes here, we need to make it go. So because after the 100s, we need to check the 40s. And the 40s, they need a loop as well, of course. Okay. Then we do the same thing we do every time. We read a value from the 1x. We subtract the value we are checking. If it's negative, we are done. So we can jump over to the next one. Otherwise, we know we have a correct value, so we can store the results. And we can bump the 20s four times. Or bump the 10s four times. I mean. Okay, this should be a valid solution that runs faster than any of those solutions before. Unless I made a mistake somewhere, which given that we are now approaching a pretty long length. I see 60s, 70s, we might have upwards of somewhere in the 80, just under 70 lines in the solution, even though the optimized version was 28. The important bit now is it fast enough? And we actually made it slower. Interesting. So, remember this set of inputs. It's always running against the same set of inputs. Well, it never has a 700 in there. So, yeah, we can cheat. And I think in order to get a perfect solution, we need to cheat. Well, cheating is such a nasty word. We need to come up with a more optimized solution. So we skip the 200 checks. Because this does save 3 points for every comparison. And this time we don't have a 79 in here. But we have 10s, 20s and 40s in here. So let's have a check. Because the fixed overhead becomes higher every time though. Because there's so many things to check. Okay, let's see how fast this was. 190. Okay. So we are back to where we were before. We are still 25 steps away from a solution and we just got a fresh set of numbers. So let's restore this solution back to what it was. That's a nice solution. And then I'm gonna call this an end to the episode. So, once again, I managed to partially optimize a solution, but I don't have a perfect one yet. And I'm gonna leave that as an exercise for you, dear watchers. If you find the solution to make this run in the appropriate time, please do let me know. I might not make another video about this, or I might, depending on if I figured out or not, but I'm gonna try to not make it block myself. I don't want to stop making videos because I can't find a perfect solution, because that will be just a waste. And especially since I'm so close to the end, I really just want to get there. So yeah, that's it. I hope you enjoyed this, and I thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you again next time. Bye bye.